Welcome to this edition of the BEC podcast. My name is Rasmus Beck, and I'm very happy to welcome two of the female players that is currently in the top of Europe in the women's doubles, Sara Thygesen and Maiken Fruergaard. Welcome to both of you. Thank you for joining us. And let's just jump straight to it, Sara and Maiken. You are the best active women's doubles pair of Denmark at the moment. Christina Pedersen and Camille Rodiul not playing at the moment. Sara, how does that feel?
Of course, it's nice, but we are quite humble, and we know that Chris and Camilla have played for many years and is a world-class player pair, so we can really learn a lot from them. I'm not like thinking that not much about it, not in the daily basis, but when you ask about it and people are asking about how is it to be number one, but yeah. It's nice, but yeah, we're still, of course, it's nice to be number one in Denmark, but our main goal is to be number one in the world. So yeah, we don't put that much into it, not at the moment.
No, Maiken, you at some point you got the news that Camilla is pregnant. Of course, it's very good for her, but it also means that now you are the top pair for Denmark. Can you remember the thoughts you have around it when you got the news?
Yeah. Like Sara said, it's nice to be number one, but still in the beginning, I felt a little bit of pressure that, okay, now we have to prove that we can do the same as they did on the, in the world. And that was a little bit hard, but then I had some good talks with the coaches, and they said, we're still young, we have to learn a lot, and they have a lot of experience that we don't have. So we don't have to show the world that we can do it now. That's a lot too much pressure for us, so we just have to keep on working on the stuff that we know that we have to be better at, and then it will come with the years.
How has things changed, Sara, for you and Maiken since Camilla retired or at least took a break from her international career?
Of course, we now got a little bit more focus, also from the coaches, because yeah, now we are number one and they are doing everything that they can, that we can improve and be better. Yeah, that's nice, of course. And also the environment and the sparring partners at the practice in Brøndby is really good. And they brought in some younger boys that can hit hard, and so we can be better in the defense and stuff like that. So there's a lot of things that is going on that we are really grateful for, and we just need to take everything we can with us and yeah, try to learn from it every day and every practice. But as Maiken says, that yeah, we are, of course, we need to do better at the World Tour, but we are slowly getting there, and yeah, it will come, but we still need to be patient.
Maiken, do you feel that you are a better player now compared to just 6 months ago due to those kind of changes that you have experienced?
Yeah, I think we got a little bit more speed in our feet now after we had a lot of practices with the boys over the summer before the world practices. And I think it's really good for us. We have also showed now that we can beat the top players, but we can't play at that same level all the time, so we have to get our baddest level a little bit higher now, so we can improve in the top.
Yeah, looking at the results you have done in 2018, looking at China Open quarterfinal, there was that the big breakthrough for you, Sara?
Yeah, right now it is, and especially also when because yeah, it's so difficult to play in these halls, and it was under these windy conditions, and it's not always that we have been playing that good, but our mindset was really, really good, and finally we feel like we controlled the win better than the other pairs, yeah, not those we lost to, but the other pairs, and those kind of things, I feel like that means a lot, because we have been playing those tournaments for the last couple of years and like getting so frustrated. Oh, I know the winners that way. Why I'm keep doing this kind of lift and stuff like that. So it was really more about this mindset and how we controlled everything. That is a big step step forward.
When Sarah is mentioning the wind here, Mike, and you're smiling all the time. How's that?
It's just yeah, we've had some bad experiences in those kind of halls. It's more like it's even rare can be a really good match or a really bad one where we can't control it. And it's a little bit annoying that we can play one day really, really good. And then the next day when for second round, if we win the first, then we can't control it at all. And then we're like, what should we do? And we go around like hitting it out and into the wind all the time. And I think we were a little bit more calm and making it simple.
But why were you more calm in China? It's not your first time, it's not your second, it's not your third time going to the eastern part of Asia to play. What made you more calm?
It's again, you need to be in those halls many times before you actually get it. It can be so easy to stand on the outside and say, okay, the wind is that way, maybe you shouldn't hit it that way. But still, when the stroke you're used to do is that way, then it's really hard. Okay, I also need to think about pushing it the other way, and we're talking about split seconds, and that just takes time to learn. So I can't say exactly what made the difference, but the more we are playing in these halls, the more we are going to learn from it.
Sarah, you said in the beginning of this interview that the big goal is being world number one. What are those things that you're still missing to be the best Asians week after week after week, as we have seen Danish doubles do before?
Yeah, we're working on a lot of stuff. We have different stuff we work on, and the same with a lot of variations from the backcourt in the windy halls. It's really important that you do variations with cuts and sticks and stuff like that instead of just hitting hard. For me, it has been a difficult way to play because it's not what I'm used to, so that's a lot of change for me and for Sarah in the big halls where it's a little bit more less windy but really slow shuttles. Then we have to be more patient and we have to learn that we can have to play the shuttles around maybe one more time before we get the chance, because those pairs can keep on running, and that's our problem usually, is not enough patience.
And you're not the patient one, Sarah?
No, I think I have involved quite well, but I still got a lot of way to do.
Yeah, it's just something around count to 10 one more time or something like that, right?
Yes. Yeah. You should see me when I was under 15, I was like always pushing forward or something like that. And yeah, at that time it worked, but it doesn't work.
But it doesn't anymore.
No, no. Not anymore. Maybe after a rally when it's 2 minutes, then I can do it. But otherwise, yeah.
Yeah. Camilla Rødehjul and Christina Pedersen are not part of the top stage anymore. The Stoiber sisters are now the defending European champions. How do you guys see European women's doubles moving forward from here?
I think it's going okay. I think the Stoiber sisters, they are also improving, and they also got some good results lately. They are also working on these how to play in these difficult conditions. So they are also learning a lot. From also Chris and Camilla, I know that they always enjoy to play against them because that's another style than that they are playing. So I think it's going okay, and yeah, they also know that they right now on the paper are the best pair in Europe, but everybody is pushing forward, and now we want to beat them all the time. So yeah, then they also need to learn from that angle.
Next year, in 2019, there will be no European Championships. There will be a European Games instead.
Yeah.
Is that a goal for you guys?
Yeah, I think it is. The first time it was held, it wasn't that high prioritized, I would say. And it was new and stuff like that. I went there in mixed double, and it was, I think it was awesome. It was quite fun to have this mini Olympic Games kind of thing. And those kind of things also, you can learn from that. It's a whole other setup, another setup. Next year, yeah, there are some more points. So of course it's a big goal, and we want to go there and we want to get a medal.
Yeah, the points, Mike, for the world ranking, what does it mean to you guys that it is actually also, you can also earn some points for doing good at the European Games?
it's a bit more pressure, because usually when we go for European tournaments and stuff like that, we maybe get a seeding and we have to, yeah, maybe get a medal or, yeah, be one of the best pairs. But that's a lot of pressure sometimes, but it's also the fun where you can play to go for the final and, you know, that you can do it.
The thoughts about the Olympics, of course, it's also in the Olympic qualification period. Is that also a reason why you are going to play the European Games?
Yeah, for sure. But we still need to get elected from a coaches and a national team and stuff. But of course, it's a big goal, and we will see about also the biggest goal for Olympic in 20. But yeah, we don't know anything about that yet. But our main goal, it could be really awesome to go there. Mm. And that's also why we always need to improve and do better and always learn from everything.
Of course, the Tokyo 2020 Olympics is a goal for every badminton player playing now. You're a young pair. 2024 Paris, is that maybe more relevant for you guys in terms of winning a medal, performing well? Mike, how do you see that?
Yeah, I think it's more, maybe more realistic to go for a medal in Paris, but it would be nice to get the experience to go there. So maybe in Paris, that you're not so, stressed up and nervous and to going on court. It would be nice to try it before without the pressure of should go for a medal, maybe. But still, you always want to win. So,
Of course. Looking at the paper. Mike, we do not see you very often anymore in mixed doubles. We see you, Sarah, a lot more. What are the thoughts around going for playing mixed doubles and not playing mixed doubles? Sarah, if you begin on your part, you're playing with Niklas Nørre. Why do you choose to play the mixed doubles as long as you also play the women's?
Mixed double has always been had a big place in my heart since I was young. It was definitely mixed double that I was the best at. I think I'm also really good in doubles now, but it took me some time to get even better in ladies doubles. But mixed doubles is more natural for me. It's more natural for me to stand on the net and stuff like that. It's an awesome game. I think so much speed, and also this mixed double category has developed really, really fast. And we see now the first seed and second seed Chinese pair, and they really hit the high level, and it's just not a whole new game, but there's so many things that has changed, and yeah, it's speed and fast, and yeah, I like it.
Yeah, and Mike, you're not playing the mixed doubles, how come?
Right now, I don't have a partner in mixed that plays the same tournaments as me, and as well, I have a lot of stuff that I have to work on at the net, where I'm not the... You don't see me that much at the net if I decide. But I practice a lot of mixed in Brøndby at the National Center. We have half mixed and women's doubles practices. So I practice a lot of mixed to exactly the speed in mixed is really good. When you go from mixed to women's doubles, it's a little bit easier to see what's happening, and everything is getting a little bit slower. So you have a little bit more time to think about what you want and to do with the shuttle. And I think it's really good for me to play and practice mixed.
So it's not because you don't want to?
No. Not right now. Mm. It's not. But for me now, it's actually fine to just have 100% focus on my women's doubles. Mm.
But Mike, to be honest, when you see Sarah going on court in a mixed doubles, and you know you're also going to play women's doubles at some point during the tournament, maybe even during the same day, how does that feel to see Sarah walking on court with Niklas, knowing that, okay, she also has to be ready to our game later on?
I'm in that good of shape. Yeah. Don't worry.
I'm always like, I don't know. I'm always like, don't play three sets. Don't play three sets. No, I think it's good for her to, then she's ready in the hall. She knows what's going on in the hall with the wind and everything when she already tried it. But I don't think that much about it. It's just the way it has been for 1.5 years now. So
you're used to it.
I'm really used to it now. Yeah. I'm just hoping that she's not too tired for the WSL.
Yeah. Ladies, the final question for you today is that if you could choose any player for a Sudirman Cup team, 5 categories, who would you pick?
I have
a list of players. You can choose whatever player you like. 5 categories. 1 Sudirman Cup team. 1 men's singles, 1 women's singles, men's doubles, women's doubles, and mixed doubles. Who's going to play your team?
Our team together?
Yeah.
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 Okay, so we have to discuss it. Team managers.
Oh.
I would maybe choose Momota.
Momota for the men's singles?
Yeah. He's really dangerous right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's really good right now.
For the women's singles then?
Oh.
That's a difficult one.
Yeah.
There are a lot of good right now. But maybe.
Yeah. It's difficult to say how they perform on a team. I don't really know. And haven't followed quite well. And also when they play this league.
Who's in the top of your mind, if you should mention some few names?
I would say Ratjanok.
Yeah, Ratjanok and Sindu. Ratjanok was my first choice.
Yeah.
I think she's good on team player. Yeah. I don't know. I have no idea.
I feel that she's a team player.
You feel that Ratjanok is a team player?
Yeah.
So we go for Ratjanok for the women's single?
Yeah, I think.
Yeah. Good. Men's doubles.
Yeah, men's doubles. Yeah.
You know quite a few good players, I suppose.
Yeah. Should Lee and Liu, maybe. Or Kim and Anas.
Yeah. They are also always good on the team.
Yeah, they're really good at team.
Kim Esterbøn and Anders Kaarup.
Yeah.
Your countrymen?
Yeah.
We'll say them. Okay, little Danish here, that's fine. Yeah, yeah. Women's doubles?
Get the flag going.
Yeah, it's on your left side.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
Yeah. Women's doubles.
Women's doubles. Us.
Yeah, if you have 4, if you have 3 other players who can win, you don't have to play, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
We want to play. Of course, there's so many Japanese pairs doing quite well at the moment.
Yeah.
I think they have 5 pairs in top.
Yeah, but I want to see how Chen and Gia is going to involve them or develop in the next future, because we saw she lost some weight, Gia, in Japan, so
maybe
they are playing
with
a lot of speed, especially some matches. So
maybe them.
Yeah. Could it be
good.
Maybe, yeah.
And final category, mixed doubles?
I would say Xing Shuwei.
Yeah.
And Huang.
Yeah.
They're doing quite well at the moment.
Yeah.
You can see that. I think he is.
Yeah, he's amazing.
So fast.
Yeah.
It's really crazy.
It's awesome for the badminton, for the court.
That, for the category. Yeah. It's really good.
But not so much when you lose to him, but. Yeah. We have something we need, always want to.
Then you have something to practice.
Exactly.
Ladies, first of all, thank you for stopping by, and thank you also for watching the BEC podcast. Stay tuned, we will soon be back with another edition of the BEC podcast.